Hello, City Life Church. How are we today? Good. Okay, who was watching that like the whole time holding your breath like, what's going to happen? I've watched that 4 times now, and I watched some of the rehearsal and coming together, and I'm still like, oh my goodness, what's going to happen? And I heard some gasps in the audience, and so I know you all enjoyed that. How about we thank Beck Ham one more time for that amazing performance. I love that God is using the spiritual gift of circus skills in our church, especially in this year of Create. And it is a wonderful year to be here at City Life and to see opportunities for us to creatively communicate the gospel. Well, I have been a part of City Life Church for 2.5 years now, and I love to call this church my home. But before I moved here to Melbourne, I was from Western Australia, from a little town called Perth. You laugh, but it is a small town. And it's fantastic. I love Perth. And I use pretty much every opportunity that I get up here to preach to let you all know that Perth has the best beaches in the world. It really does. There was a chuckle that was quite loud coming from over there. But I have to say, if you really, it's the best. The best beaches you will ever see. And so why should today be any different? I'm just going to once again declare it. As a child, I grew up going to the beach all the time. And I was at the beach pretty much every day. And I used to be very brown because I would be in the sun all day. And I'm actually Latin American, so I'm quite pale considering my heritage. And I go over to Perth, go back to Perth now. And my friends will ask me like, oh gosh, are you sick? And I'm like, no, I just live in Melbourne. We don't really get a lot of sunshine. So I was just so like at the beach all the time growing up. And it's a very different lifestyle here. One time when we were little, we spent a whole month camping at the beach, and it was fantastic. And I remember we didn't have a shower, so we'd have to, it was this massive bucket, and we'd stand in the bucket and Mum would pour like fresh water over our heads, and that was our shower. And it was the best month ever. It was so much fun. And we all had boogie boards growing up. Do you guys know what a boogie board is? Some of you know, some of you don't know. They're about yay high, and it's a piece of plastic foam type thing. I don't know what it's made out of, but it floats in the water. And basically, you take it into the water with you, and when there's waves coming, you just throw your body onto the board, and the waves just carry you to the shore. And it is so much fun. We would spend hours upon hours playing with our boogie boards in the water. Mine was pink and had flowers on it. I loved it. And Dad would sit on the shore watching us play, and we would just spend all this time mucking around. And what we would notice, though, is the more fun we were having in the beach and the more time we spent in the water, that we would slowly drift further and further away from Dad, who was on the beach. Who knows that sort of feeling when you're in the water and you drift and you start off in Phillip Island, you feel like you end up in Geelong, you know, drift along. And so we would have to get our boogie boards and get out of the water and trudge our way back to Dad and start the adventure again. And that was just the fun of life as kids. And we never intended to drift away from where Dad was. We never intended to go further down the beach from when he was. But we were just so caught up in what we were doing that we just took our eyes off him. And we just ended up somewhere else. Now, we are in a series called U-Turn, and it's all about that. It's all about how we find ourselves sometimes far away from our Maker, far away from our Father, who sits on the shore patiently waiting for us, and sometimes we don't even notice that we've drifted away a little bit. And how do we come back and restore our hearts to Him? So this week, we're looking at the topic of restoration, and we want to talk about that. How do we draw closer to Him in this season? We are constantly bombarded in this world with advertising, with things that try to pull our attention from God. In fact, in Australia alone, companies spend a combined total of over $17 billion, not million, billion dollars on advertising. We are saturated with advertising on television, on radio, on Spotify. You can't even go to the grocery store without them product placing some Cadbury bars at the counter. tempter ready to tempt you and take your attention away. And it's not just limited to the shopping center or the world of entertainment. I mean, you can't drive your car more than 5 kilometers out of the church car park here at Knox without being tempted by the $1 coffee and my personal favorite, the $2 slushies at the local 7-Eleven. And all these things come and they grab our attention, and then we have these little computer things in our pockets called phones, and they bing and they bop with notifications. You've missed Candy Crush today. Give it another go. Your friend's trying to message you on Facebook. This person's on Signal. Now we're going to WhatsApp, and all of these people chatting away and talking to us on our phone. There is so much going on in our world that vies for our attention. Life is full of distractions. And sometimes it's not even little trivial things that take our attention away. Sometimes it's good big things that are happening in our world that pull us away from the purpose of God for our lives. My husband and I, we have recently started to look into buying a house. Now, we got married recently, and we did not think that buying a house was something that was going to be on our radar for the next 5 to 10 years, because somebody spent all of their savings on trips to Europe in their 20s, and I don't apologize, it was fantastic. So we were like, it's going to take ages before we can afford to buy a house. But lo and behold, the government shut down international borders, so it's been very good for my savings plan. And we are now in a position where we can look into buying a house, not a big house, but a small house, but we can still buy a house nonetheless. So at first, I had these big dreams about what our first house was going to be, okay? I was like, well, it has to be 4 bedrooms, obviously. One for me, one for my husband, one for us, and maybe one for my French bulldog. And so had all these plans, and I was like, obviously, I'm going to need 2 bathrooms. One of them will need to have a spa bath, and I must have a butler's pantry. A butler's pantry is very important to me. And I had these grand, grand plans. And as we looked at our budget and compared what's happening out in the Melbourne real estate market, again, I come from Perth where everything is $5, okay? So, you know, back in here in Melbourne, it's, I mean, the prices are high. And looking at our budget, looking at the cost of housing here in Melbourne, and it was like, I probably will not get that butler's pantry from the looks of it. And so we had to change my expectations. I had to readjust. And in that time, I was just getting so caught up in looking at the things around me, thinking, oh, goodness, are we ever going to afford to have this? And are we going to afford to have the things that I want and the things that we want? And I was getting so distracted by it, and I started to get very discouraged. Are we even going to be able to afford walls, for goodness sake? This is ridiculous. And at one point, I turned to my husband and I said, I just want us to be successful. And I felt in that moment, the Holy Spirit just punched me in the chest and asked me, is that your idea of success, Brisita? And I was like, oh, that's a good point, Holy Spirit. I will think about that. And I just felt so challenged and felt so remorseful in that moment. Just thinking, when did this become my idea of success? My husband and I have never been people that have been like, we want to buy a house. In fact, it's only the last couple of months that we've talked about it. Before that, our hope for our home was that we would open up the doors to everyone in our community to come, to people in our church, to have an open space where people can come and eat and be encouraged and just be sharing the love of Jesus with them, with our neighbors, with our church community, with our young adults. And that's always been our heart for our home. It's never been about buying a house. But I just lost sight of it. I lost sight of it. I got distracted and I drifted away ever so slightly. And I had to come back to this place to being, God, what do you want from my home? God, what is it that you desire of me and our home for the people that we serve? And this is something that we can so easily do. Buying a house, it's not a bad thing, but sometimes we can turn it into something that it's not meant to be, something that God doesn't desire for us. In Psalm 73, we read about this poet, songwriter of his time, and he's facing this similar distraction. Now, he starts off the psalm nice and strong. He starts off in Psalm 73, verse 1. He writes, surely God is good to Israel. It'll come up. He writes, surely God is good to Israel for those who are pure in heart. So he knows who God is. He's like, God is good. Surely he is good. Not just little bit, like maybe he's good. Surely he is good to Israel for those who are pure in heart. This is a guy who was one of the most well-known worship leaders of his time. He was like the coolest guy, probably not wearing skinny jeans like worship leaders do today, but he was like well-known worship leader. And he was the worship leader for King David, possibly even for King Solomon. And so he knew who God was, and he was a God-honoring guy. But he comes along and he gets distracted. He gets distracted. And this is the first thing that sort of happens to us when we get caught up in the cycle of the world around us. And he writes in the following two verses, he says, "But as for me, my feet had almost slipped. I had nearly lost my foothold, for I envied the arrogant when I saw the prosperity of the wicked." And church, I wonder today, have you ever found yourself distracted by envy? Have you ever found yourself distracted by the things that are around you, by the opportunities that are around you, that you take your eyes off Jesus just for a moment? Instead of keeping his eyes on God, he sees others and he sees those that don't even worship God and he starts to envy their lives. He's distracted by everything he's seeing around him and he's wondering, why is it that these people who don't worship God have all of this stuff and I don't? And so from that, he starts to develop a distorted view of the world. When we are in a place of distraction away from God, we start to distort our thinking. And he writes in verses 4-9, he writes, "For there are no pangs in their death." These people, they don't even feel death, like nothing bad happens to them. "But their strength is firm. They are not in trouble as other men, nor are they plagued like other men. Therefore, pride serves as their necklace. Violence covers them like a garment. Their eyes bulge with abundance. They have more than their heart could wish. They scoff and speak wickedly concerning oppression. They speak loftily. They set their mouth against the heavens, and their tongue walks through the earth. Nothing happens to them." They don't even follow God. They're not hungry during 21 days of prayer and fasting, and they're doing fine. Why is that? And he has this distorted view of the world. And so, you know, obviously people struggle in life. We all struggle. But he looks at their struggles and thinks, they're not even struggling. They're fine. So his mind starts to get messy. When we get distracted from the things of the world, our minds get messy. And it goes on and it leads to a place of discouragement. The psalmist goes on to write, "Therefore, his people return here, and waters of a full cup are drained by them. And they say, how does God know? How does God know? And is there even knowledge in the Most High? Is there knowledge in the Most High?" And there's a place of this discouragement that's happening. And the wheel keeps turning. And of course, as he takes his eyes off God, he's more tempted by the things around him. And the things around him just don't satisfy anymore. And so he goes to a place of disillusionment. And he writes, "Behold, these are the ungodly who are always at ease. They increase in riches. Surely I have cleansed my heart in vain." I want you to notice the pronouns here and how he says, he goes from talking about they and them. He says, "Behold, these people, they increase in riches." And notice how it changes to I. "Surely I have cleansed my heart. I have cleansed my heart in vain." He's gone from a place of looking around him and now he's internalizing this pain, internalizing this grief. And it's this cycle of distraction that leads to distortion, that leads to discouragement, and that leads to disillusionment. And what the psalmist is struggling with here is something that we all struggle with at times. Those moments where we wonder if God is really in this or not. Those moments where we desire comfort, and that comfort takes over our seeking of God and what he really wants for us. Those moments where we look outside of him to the world and we hope that what's in the world will fulfill that longing of our heart, those places that God can only reach. And we want those things in our world. We want comfort. So many of us, we desire comfort. We want a comfortable church service. We want a comfortable experience so we can fully worship God. We want conflict-free relationships so we can truly love one another. We want a job that gives us more benefits and more income and more opportunities so that we can comfortably participate in mission one day. And we live our lives thinking that we're seeking God in these things. But really, true surrender is not this Western ideology of what comfort is. It's not about doing church in a comfortable way or worship in a comfortable way or relationships in a comfortable way or mission in a comfortable way. And like the psalmist, we've been looking at the world and getting distracted, longing for the wrong things, longing for the things of this world rather than just sitting with God. And we've drifted. We're like that child playing in the ocean, drifting away, not realizing that maybe they've taken little steps away. And eventually when we look up again, we've gone further away. But God, he doesn't leave us in that place. And God wants so much more for us than this. This is the God of restoration that we serve. And he is so much more. And he wants to restore so much of himself to us. That is so much the case, I believe, coming out of this COVID season, where we had a year, it's almost a year to the day, where we had to close people coming into the church building. And where we had to go online and we were shaken by this pandemic. I think the church was shaken by fear in this time. And we as a church people, we were displaced. We were displaced and we were ripped out of our comfort, our rhythms of meeting face to face and not seeing our friends' smiling faces on the weekend. And we were put into this place where we had to seek God in new ways, in uncomfortable ways. And I'm talking sometimes even physically uncomfortable, breathing through masks in these sorts of ways, in ways that challenge our ideas of what it means to worship, to gather, our ideas of being the church. And I believe that God has been speaking to us in this time. And Beck, you know, she displayed that in the wheel. When you see the start, she was going round and round in circles, just not really going anywhere. But when she came out of the wheel and went and then did a U-turn back, she started to play and delight and enjoy and do even cooler tricks for us to ooh and ah at. And I think that's what God wants to call us back to. It's not about getting caught up in the rhythms of us coming back to church and being face to face and getting caught up in that just going around the rhythms of just doing church life. God wants so much more for us than that. He wants to shake up our comfort. And I really believe that in this time, God is speaking to us as a church, saying, church, I am not only found in your building. And I am not only found in your programs. And I am not only found in your worship set. I am the great I am. Like he spoke to Moses all those thousands of years ago, I am who I am. And come and restore your hearts to me. Come and restore your hearts to true worship. I am bigger than your comfort. I am greater than your routines. Just come and be with me. Come and be with me. And this is exactly what the psalmist discovers. He goes on to write, he says, nevertheless, I am continually with you. You hold me by my right hand. You will guide me with your counsel and afterward receive me to glory. And from this disillusionment, he turns around. He turns his attention to God. Look at that. He says, nevertheless, despite everything I see around me, despite everything that is happening around me, the temptations and the things that I want and the desires that I have, no. You are God and you alone are what I am going to seek after. And I want you to notice how the pronouns change one more time in this. He's gone from they to I feel discouraged and I feel sad to now he's saying, no, you, God, are good. You are great. He's gone from putting his eyes and looking around him to internalizing it to now looking up and saying, no, you are the great I am. That is who you are. And you are the one that I will seek comfort and counsel from. And he's changed his attention. His attention has gone to God. What breaks the cycle of distraction is giving our attention to the things of God. And when we put our attention on the things of God, It changes our hearts. It changes our lives. Just like Beck started playing with that wheel, and it's breathtaking. It's joyful. It's wonderful. And it fills so many of those spaces that we long for in our world. In Hebrews 2:1, it says, we must pay the most careful attention to what we have heard so that we do not drift away. And so the psalmist goes on to finish. He writes, whom have I in heaven but you? And there is none upon earth that I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. For indeed, those who are far from you shall perish. You have destroyed all those who desert you for harlotry. But it is good for me to draw near to God. I have put my trust in Lord God, that I may declare all your works. From this attention that he gives God, he pulls away from distraction, he gives his attention to God, and you can see he starts to acknowledge who God is. He starts to say, who do I have in heaven but you? Who on earth is as good as you are, God? And that acknowledgement turns into appreciation. My flesh might fail, but God is my strength, the strength of my heart. I will trust in the Lord God and declare all of your works. And so what looked like this in his world, this cycle of just monotonous going around and just the same thing over and over again, now looks like this. He was distracted, and then his attention is taken off the things of this world and put back on God in its rightful place, and we see acknowledgement, appreciation, and adoration flowing. This is the power of the U-turn. It doesn't take you back to where you started. It doesn't take you back to that place of distraction and distortion and discouragement and disillusionment. It takes you to a new place. It takes you in a new direction where we can restore our hearts to God. And that is the power of prayer and fasting, church. It grabs our attention. It disrupts our comfort. It challenges our routines, and it U-turns our lives, setting us back on track to God. I love the way author and poet Mary Oliver puts it. She writes, attention is the beginning of devotion. Attention is the beginning of devotion. It's interesting. It's so interesting that throughout the life of Jesus, when you look at the gospel, he asks his disciples to continuously stay awake, pay attention. And he does so more so as he's going closer to the cross. He writes, this is the way a commentator put it. He writes, throughout his life, Jesus kept saying things like, stay alert, keep watch, and don't fall asleep. As he approached his death, these reminders grew in frequency and intensity. And you can see them all listed there, Mark 13, 5, 34, 35, 37. They're all there. At one point, Jesus compared the time of his coming to the days of Noah, when people eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage. Obviously, Jesus wasn't anti-eating or anti-marriage. The problem was much deeper. When the flood finally came in the times of Noah, no one saw it coming because they forgot to focus. So Jesus drives the point home by saying, therefore, keep watch. In a world that pulls our attention away, Jesus calls us to pay attention, to keep watch. Now, church, I don't know about you, but I am not great at keeping attention. I am very, very easily distracted. In fact, throughout this whole message, it is taking every piece of willpower in me not to say hi to Sepa and Harsha, who are sitting in front of me. But hi, guys. So, as you can see, I'm very bad at it. So I'm not good at keeping my attention on things. I'm a bit like a toddler. You have to put something shiny in front of me, and I'm like, oh, I'm back. Look, I am the first person to admit that during a season of prayer and fasting, I have been thoroughly tempted by the smell of bread in a toaster, and I have drifted away from that. Or I'm tempted by what's happening on my phone. I pick up and scroll through social media. And it's not just in seasons of prayer and fasting. I think this is something that happens to us in our daily world, and it happens to me. I know for me, when I'm frustrated by something, I will so readily call a friend to vent to them and say, you won't believe what happened, rather than going to talk to Jesus about it first. Or if I'm feeling especially sad, instead of running to Jesus with my sadness, I will run to Ben and Jerry's that is sitting in my freezer, loaded up with chocolate sauce, and help myself. There are times where I'm bored and I could spend that time reading the Word of God and drawing closer to him, but instead I spend time with my friend Disney Plus. And then, you know, I had this amazing opportunity to study at Bible college, and I'm not even a good steward of that sometimes. Sometimes the only time I bring God into my studies is at the very last hour where I am praying for a miracle to get that assignment done on time. Can anyone relate? Yeah. It's those little things, you know, they're not like these big glaring, like, you know, sins that we talk about. It's just like, it's those little things that just drift us a little bit further and further away. And then Dad's all the way over there. And it's up to us to pick ourselves back and U-turn to come back to him. And I have to ask myself in this moment where I drift, Brisita, what are you living for? Are you living for the things of this world? Are you going to get distracted by them? Or are you going to give your heart to Jesus? Are you going to devote yourself to Jesus? I love the way author and pastor John Tyson writes about it in his latest book called Beautiful Resistance. He writes, if we get our hearts right, there we go. If we get our hearts right, everything will follow. We need to make sure that in our times of stress and sorrow and in celebration of our triumphs, we turn our hearts to God in gratitude and prayer and worship, inviting him into the places of anxiety and fear rather than medicating them by looking to some temporary solution, Netflix and pizza, or gossip, exercise, working more, whatever it is for you. Feel like a wonderful comfort at the moment. But if we use these to fend off dependence on God, we delay our deliverance. God is at war for the love of your heart. He just wants your heart, church. At the very end of the day, our lives will be the sum of what we paid attention to. Whether we chose to pay attention to those things or whether we just landed there by default, our lives will be the sum of what we have paid attention to. So how do we do this? How do we introduce this into our world so we don't sneak away and drift off a little bit? Well, there's a few things that I like to do that help me along the track, and I thought I'd share them with you today. The first one is having a rhythm of connecting with God. It might be setting aside an hour a day or half an hour a day, an appointment in your calendar that you cannot miss. When Andrew Chisholm, our senior minister, calls me or messages me or sends me an email saying, I have an appointment, we have an appointment, you must come, you must be at this meeting at this time, I am only a couple of times have I been late. Maybe a few times. But I go to the appointment. I don't miss it. I don't forget about it. When it pops up in my calendar, I don't think, well, it's just Andrew. No, I make sure I am there and I make sure that I am ready and I'm there on time. And, you know, it should be even more so with God. It should be even more so with Jesus. And so putting that time aside, locking it into your calendar and creating a daily rhythm of that is really important. I have a friend that sets alarms on his phone. As he has an alarm that goes off in the morning, in the afternoon, and in the evening. And he uses that as like, right, that's my 10 minutes of power prayer with God. And so he goes away and he finds somewhere quiet at work and he will pray through those 10 minutes. And he will just spend that time with Jesus. And that's his rhythm and reminder. I know for some of us, it's stopping doing things. This year, I've decided no more apps on my phone. That is my rhythm. No more. And I will not put any more apps on my phone or anything new because I'm tired of the distractions. And I want to just not be so distracted from what God calls me to do. The second thing that we can do is writing. And I think journaling prayers is one of the hardest things I've ever had to learn to do. I am not someone who likes to sit down and write about my feelings. I'm like, dear diary. Like, I'm not that girl. And so, but getting into this routine of journaling, I was really challenged once to give it a go. And now I can just spend so much more time writing out my prayers. And I'm spending so much more time in prayer because I'm writing them down. And so that's something that can really help us focus. Having a list of people to pray for, having a list in your phone. So when someone says to you at church, oh, could you pray for me for this, it's not like, yeah, I'll pray for you and then we forget. I've actually got it written down, ready to go. I like to have a post-it note in my car of people that I'm praying for, or just the post-it note says pray. So when I'm driving through the suburb of Bayswater where I live, I'm reminded, pray for your suburb, pray for your street. And so I'm praying for my suburb, I'm praying for my street, I'm praying for my community, for my neighbors as I drive past their houses. And I'm reminded to do that because I've written it down. and I put it in my car. Keep your eyes on the road though, that's important. Okay, and the third thing I like to do is have good relationships. So have people in your world to keep you accountable. A friend that you can go on a prayer walk with, a friend that you can call and have prayer together with. And another thing that I do with my friends is that we have this accountability that we've introduced this year about only coming to talk to each other about issues that we're facing at work or in our world. Only after we've spoken to God about it, only after we've taken it to God in prayer and read the Bible for some counsel. And so my friends and I will ask each other now on the phone when I say, oh, I'm really struggling with this. The first question we know to ask each other is, have you taken that to God? What has he said? And we like stop it now. And it's this thing that we're trying to do to bring God more into our conversations and into accountability around keeping God at the center of what we do and really going to Jesus first. And it's been challenging, let me tell you, but it's been really growing me. And the last thing I think that we can do is reflection. Reflection. Keeping God in the right place as our Heavenly Father, reflecting on who He is and what He has done, meditating on the Word of God, reflecting on things in our past that He's redeemed us from and restored us from, and reflecting on the goodness that He has for our future. Now, if you know a little bit about me, I was single for a very long time. And I say that slowly because it was that long, okay? I got married at the ripe old age of 37. Yes, I was a late bloomer. And I, you know, as a single person in growing up in church and being in church, being single in your 30s is, let me tell you, it is challenging. Everyone's like, when are you getting married? Let me pray that over you, which is very lovely. And I was like, yes, give me the prayer. I need it. But it's, you know, it's this thing. And I, you know, now I'm so blessed. I have lots of young women in young adults and women in their 30s who often come and chat to me about their struggles in being single in the church at that age group. And I feel so privileged that I got married later in life because it means that I can speak into that space and speak about the hope of God into those spaces. So an incredible privilege to be a part of that. But when I got married, some very, very well-meaning, I just want to stress that, very well-meaning people came up to me and they said, oh, wow, hasn't God finally been faithful to you? Hasn't God finally answered those prayers that we've been praying for years over you? And, you know, some of you know my story. I was engaged before a long time ago and my fiancé passed away before our wedding. So a lot of people would look at my story and they would think, oh, like God has restored and God has redeemed the things of her past and God has proved himself faithful to her. But upon taking this time to reflect on the things that God has brought me through, the things that have been prayed over me, I think about the faithfulness of God and I realize, no, God has not been faithful to me because I am married, as great as my husband is. God has always been faithful to me because that is who God is. God is just faithful, that is who he is. And he was faithful to me before I was engaged, while my fiance passed away, when I'm single again, and now in my marriage. He has always been there. And that is the faithfulness of God. It's his ever being present in our lives. And when we look at that, and we look at the power of what Jesus did on the cross, where he overcame death, that is the faithfulness of God. It is a God that is continuously coming back to us and constantly wanting to restore himself and our relationship with him. And he sends his son Jesus to die on a cross for us. That is the faithfulness of God. That is the prize that we need to pursue in our lives, church. It's not about having a husband or buying a house or having the ideal holiday or having the perfect family or having the things of this world. The prize is Jesus. The prize is Jesus. And that is what we need to be reflecting on in our days, in this world that comes and tries to pull our attention any which way. We need to be a people that would stop and draw our attention on Jesus because he is the prize. He is the most faithful. He is the one that never fails. He is the one who has mercy. He is the one that is always with us. He is the one that overcame death so that we could be in right relationship with him. That is what we live for, church. That is the true heart of adoration. It's not the distractions of this world. It is Jesus. And we look, when we look at the cross, when we look and the hands and the feet that were pierced on Calvary for us, how can our response be anything but, God, I am not worthy? How can I not give you my affection? How can I not give you my attention? How can I not give you my adoration? That is what we live for, church. Not the distractions, but that restored heart to Jesus. I want to take a moment to pray for us as a church, because this is my prayer for us as City Life Church. And as I was preparing this message, I really felt God say, this is a prayer for City Life, that we would be a church that isn't distracted, that isn't pursuing comfort, that isn't idolizing these constructs we have about how we're meant to be church and do church, but instead we would just go and be the hands and feet of Jesus. That we would learn to sit with the great I am and just let him be the great I am without our distractions, without anything that pulls us away from just adoring him. So how about we stand, church? Let me pray for us. And why don't you stretch out your arms if you want to receive. Father God, we thank you that you are the ever-present God, that you have never, no matter what low we have experienced or what high we experience, you have never and will never leave us. That is who you are, God, and we declare your faithfulness today, no matter what we're facing. We declare your faithfulness, and we declare that you are King of Kings, that you are Lord of Lords, and we put you in the right place today in our lives, God, in the smallest part of our lives and the largest part of our lives. We say to you, God, take it all. Take all that I am. Take all that I have, God, and I place it before you, Lord, as an offering. We thank you so much, God, for your son, Jesus, for the work on the cross, God, that he overcame death so that we could be in right relationship with you, Lord. We thank you for that sacrifice so that we no longer have to sacrifice. And I thank you, Father, that we would keep Jesus at the center of who we are as a church, that we would not be distracted, that we would not try to push for anything outside of a Christ-centered fellowship. And God, we're sorry if we have drifted. We're sorry, God, for those moments where maybe we were too in love with our own comfort, that we vied after things that we weren't meant to chase after. And Jesus, we put you back on that throne today. And we declare that you are on the throne and that you never fail. And we give you the worship, God, that you deserve and the adoration that you deserve, God. And help us to stay in this place as a church, God. Help us to never waver from that, to never leave that, God. And Lord, we thank you for the Holy Spirit, for our friend and our counselor, that he would guide us and help us to stay close to you. Help us to be a church that reaches out beyond our programs and beyond our weekly service, Lord, that we would not get caught up in this wheel of distraction, but that we would freely dance with you and adore you all the days of our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, church.